How many people here are hungry for the Holy Spirit? And today I just want to share some things that I believe will help us to understand a few things and perhaps to break a few things. I don't know if you've noticed recently, but I believe that God wants to break down the strongholds that get around our lives, the religiosity. How many people know that we can be religious and going to church and still not meeting with God properly? You know what I mean? And I believe that God wants us to meet with Him. Jesus is our model. And I believe that we're living in a day when the church is being overtaken by the world. It's being bombarded with thinking and things that are wrong. And today you can't really separate Christianity from the world system. There's so much things that we've taken on board. I believe to understand the role and authority of the church, and as a believer, we have to have, I believe, as our example, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He is our example. It's very easy to follow a movement that's successful. It's very, very easy to follow somebody that's done something great for God. And we've got all stories, and I read those stories. We've got Tommy Hicks and Catherine Kuhlman and great people like that. But really, Jesus Christ has to be our example, not those people. Because you find it with a lot of those people, they made mistakes and they fell and they did things that are wrong. But we serve a Savior that never failed, amen? And He will never, ever fail us and never, ever separate us. But I believe that as a people, we've got to somehow or other look at Jesus as our perfect example. And I believe that's what we're going to do in this house, amen? I'd like for you to open up your Bibles to the book of Ephesians, chapter 4. And this is what he says in the word, verse 11. It says, "And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men, in the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things under Him who is the head, Christ." I believe that what God wants to do is He wants His church to grow up. He wants His church not to be like children tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine, by every whim, by every little thing that's going on around the place. Because there's a lot of things out there that really aren't of God. There are a lot of things there that are substitutes. There are a lot of things that are trying to take the place of what God has for us. I believe if there's ever a time that we need Holy Ghost-filled evangelists, apostles, prophets, pastors and teachers, it must be today, amen? If ever there's a day that we really need Holy Ghost-filled churches. Verse 15 is speaking about the truth in love, that we may grow up in all things under Him who is the head, Christ. Don't follow fads, follow Jesus. I believe that our aim is to be Christ-like. Is that your aim today? To be Christ-like, to be like Christ. I believe that God's eternal plan is to make man in Christ's image. God wants somehow or other, the Bible says right in the very beginning that God created man in His own image, in the image of God He created every man, every woman, every child. There's a war that's going on right now to take away man from that position that God has for him. And today there are many things that are not true, that are not real, and somehow or other the church has taken them on board. Don't follow fads, follow Jesus. I believe that God's aim is for us to be Christ-like. God has an eternal plan for man to be in Christ's image, to be Christ-like. Jesus himself said this in John 14, verse 12. He said, most assuredly. You know, when I see most assuredly, it's like as if, listen, I want you really to get this. I am not joking with you. I'm not trying to lead you up a garden path. I'm not trying to give you something there that you cannot attain. I'm not going to tell you something there that is impossible for you to reach. But most assuredly, honestly, sincerely, I want you to know that the things that you see me doing, you can do also. You can become just like me, he's saying. You can carry the same mantle. You can carry the same anointing. You can carry the same victory because the same Holy Spirit that raised Christ from the dead is now dwelling in you. The same power that God operated through Jesus Christ in is now in us. See, if the enemy can steal from us and rob from us that we do not know who we really are, well, friend, we will walk aimlessly through life. Jesus said, the things that and most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than this will he do, because I go to my Father. You see, when Jesus went to the Father, he did something so powerful that I believe that if we can capture it, and if we can somehow or other receive what God has done for us, it will empower us. It will help us to overcome. It will help us to triumph. We won't allow just our emotions or our hurts or our whatever it might be to control our lives, but we will somehow or other rise above it. Rise above it, because you see, when Jesus went through, even as David was talking about, as Abraham was going to sacrifice his son, there's something on the inside of him that was greater than the circumstance or the situation that he was witnessing with his eyes. He knew that God, somehow or other, was going to provide a sacrifice. He knew that God, even if he slew his son, even if he put that knife right into his chest, even if he as fans. Even if he lit the fire and all he had left was ashes, if that's all that he had left, that somehow or other God would raise him up. Amen. God would raise this one up. And so Jesus had said, when I go to my Father, I'm going to send the mighty Holy Spirit. And this Holy Spirit, this person of the Holy Spirit, he's going to come into your lives. He is going to empower you. See, the Bible says that you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And that power that is within us, God, I believe, wants to stir again. He wants to stir it again on the inside of us to cause us to rise above and have a confidence. And we were singing today about joy, and we're talking about a declaration. And I believe that sometimes our declaration is not a positive declaration. Sometimes our declaration is a negative thing. And we talk about the negatives of life and the impossibilities of life and you know, all these things. Perhaps God doesn't want to do this, and perhaps God doesn't want to heal me. Perhaps God doesn't want me to be prosperous. Perhaps God, and we get all this confusion, and our head is like a tangled mess. Our mind is the bombardment of our mind. And I believe that God wants to open our understanding. And I guess I want to share this morning on the need to have our minds renewed. The need to think right. To need to be able to understand that if God be for me, who can be against me? To understand that nothing is too hard for God. That God will make a way for us. And I want to read to you this morning in the book of Romans, if you'd like to turn to Romans. And Romans chapter 12. And it says here, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. I want you just to come and somehow or other submit yourself to God. Not your ways, not your ideas, but somehow or other say, God, I don't understand all of this, but my God, I believe that you are my God. And I believe that you love me with an everlasting love. I believe that you love me so much that you gave your son to die for me. And I believe that you sent the mighty Holy Spirit to empower me, that I could live above and not beneath, that I could triumph over the enemy, that I could live a victorious Christian life, that I don't have to be like a child tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine, running after this and running after that and running after this ministry and running after that ministry. But my God, I want to run after you. I want to run after Jesus. I want to draw from the mighty reservoir of power and victory and triumph and whatever it might be, the healing virtue, the power of God, the anointing, whatever is available. I want to draw. I want to get to that place. I want to get to the underneath the spout where the glory comes out. Amen. And I believe, friends, that we, the church, have to position ourselves. We can be out there running to and fro and after all these sort of things and you know, whatever it might be. But God, I believe, wants to bring us to a place where we get under that place of anointing, where God can do the work that he wants to do in our lives. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, which is your reasonable service. Friend, that's just the beginning. That's what God expects of us. God expects that of us. Amazing verses of scripture here. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. I believe that the world system is penetrating deep into the church. It's pouring out into the church and it's very, very difficult to what's the world and what's the church anymore? What's the world system and what's the spirit system? How do we change? How do we change things? Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God? That you may be able to prove what is that good. Don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed. I believe the devil has a plan to get the church to become and think like the world. To become and think like the world. And the closer that we get to the return of the Lord Jesus Christ, the hotter it's going to get. The closer we get, the worse it's going to get. There's going to be people there, the churches are just going to be so worldly. The media, which should be the greatest evangelistic tool, has been overtaken by evil forces bent on destructing the church and God's creation. So we've got to understand that there's an enemy out there, and that enemy will try to do whatever he can to destroy the church and the plan of God. Television, I believe, has been used in an amazing way by the enemy. Television has a vision to tell. It's got a vision. There is an attack on the minds of men and women and children today. Children are being bombarded through television and media outlets and different things that they've got today, with the occult, with the supernatural, with stuff there that's just so demonic. And people are just letting their kids, because it becomes a child-minding tool. But what they don't understand is that those children are being their minds are being transformed. And they've got this thing now. You know, today, that if you spoke to most children and you told them there's a spaceship that's just landed out there and there's spacemen running around, they would go out to have a look. Because they've been programmed to believe all this sort of stuff. We've got young teenagers today that as they watch some of these movies and things that for their program for their minds, it changes their way of thinking on being pure before God. And immorality has raged, and young people today, we're watching them as drugs and alcohol and free sex and goodness knows what is just destroying mankind. and media and all this sort of stuff. And when we get saved, we bring, I don't know about you, but when I got born again, something happened on the inside of me, but there was a lot of me that stayed the same. My thinking stayed the same. The way I lived stayed the same. I remember when I got born again, there was, I got saved and I read the word and I wanted God, but there were certain things in my life that I never ever thought that I would ever overcome. And so I had this thing in my mind, I'll never be able to overcome that. I'm just going to have to be like that. That's me. That's my makeup. And that's it. Until I started to read the word of God and God started to change the way I thought. And I started to say, hey, if I'm saying that, my mind is being taken away from the things of God. I've got to have my mind renewed and I've got to start to say, God, nothing is too difficult for you. There's no sickness, no disease, there's no habit, there's nothing that can separate us from the power of God. And as I said before, we've got to get ourselves under the spout where the glory comes out. We've got to get ourselves under that place where God can speak to us, where God can challenge us, where we make a decision to change. And we apply the word of God and you find the victory. I never ever thought I'd be able to stop from swearing. I thought that because I was a carpenter, that was part of my life. You just had to swear at those 4-inch nails. They wouldn't go through that southern hardwood. You just had to, and that's the way I thought. And I said to God, God, I don't know how you ever gonna help me to stop this, because I never ever thought about it. It just happened. You know what I mean? Something I just did. And now I'm born again. I don't want to do that. I remember I was filling up my car at a service station one day as a born again person. And I was talking to the guy that the car over from me. This is the old days when you had to, and I'm there talking to him, how you guys, and I was saying a few adjectives there that weren't very nice. And as I put the thing back, I turned around and here was my minister standing right behind me. Man, I thought, my God. Then I realized, hey, but Jesus, you're with me every moment of the day. You hear me every day. And so I said, God, you're going to have to help me. And I tell you what, when you ask God to help you and you ask him, say, please come, he starts to work with you. And I want to tell you, I've been speaking for about 10 minutes and I don't think I've swore once yet. But see, God wants to help us with our infirmities and with our weaknesses and things like that. But there's an attack on the minds of men and women today that this is normal or it's not normal. I believe that the church is slowly drifting away from the ways of God. Worship and praise and the anointing and the power and people coming out the front and being prayed for and allowing the anointing of God to wash over them. Friend, it's the anointing that breaks the yoke. It's the anointing that will set us free. Amen. I don't know about you, but I want the anointing. I need the anointing of God. I don't want just another sermon. I just don't want to hear another message. I want the anointing of God that will challenge me, that will speak to me. I got up early the other morning and I turned on what's her name? Joyce. Joyce Myers, Auntie Joyce. No relation. And there she was, and she was talking away. And next minute, bang, she got me. You like getting caught by the Holy Ghost? And I was watching Joel Osteen and he's there preaching away. And all of a sudden, the camera just went straight onto his face. That's all. The whole screen was his face, and it was like as if he was in my room talking to me. And it was just saying things. And I'm thinking, my God, I think I got it. I think I got it, amen? See, it's the anointing. Somebody say it's the anointing. It's the anointing, amen. It's finding that place. It's coming under the spout where the glory comes out. It's positioning yourself to hear what God's saying. It's renewing your mind. It's renewing the way you speak. It's renewing the way you think. It's renewing things. And you've got to say, this thing is not going to last forever. This thing will change in Jesus' name, because God, there is nothing too hard for you. All things are possible to those who believe. If you believe, these things that I do, you shall do also. You can say, I'm a nobody, I'm a nothing. I want to tell you, friends, that is the greatest lie you'll ever say about yourself, because I want to tell you, you are somebody. You are a child of God, and you carry the anointing. You carry the presence of God, and greater is He that's within you than He that's within the world. And you carry the power of God, and you can speak to the mountains, and you can command them in Jesus' name to be removed, and they must obey if you believe. But friend, don't you go around saying, I can't do anything, I can't do anything, I can't do anything, I'm no good, I'm a loser, I'm a no good, and then come to church and then somehow or other put your holy grail on and think that you're going to be everything to everybody. That won't work. Amen? That won't work. We've got to be changed. And I want to tell you, I believe that God is training us and changing us and getting us ready for the greatest battle. Hallelujah. I believe that there's things coming that I believe that God's going to be so amazed, and we're going to be so amazed. I mean, we've got to do some things. The church is slowly drifting away from the ways of God into a feel-good, comfortable, I don't know, some worry-free lifestyle. I don't know what it is. A lot of churches today, they want to copy other churches. So they look at, they're successful. I can glean from people's success. And I say, praise God, what you've done for others, you can do for us. Amen. I want to tell you, friends, painting your church black because some other church paints their church black, that's not going to bring revival. That's just going to change your color of your church. Amen? Doing this and doing that. That's not going to, I tell you what's going to bring revival, coming into the presence of God. I'm coming into the presence of God, filled with His Spirit and filled with His love. Amen. We're coming into something, and we're coming under something, and we're getting into that place where God can get a hold of us. We want to throw our hands in the air. We want to worship the King of Kings. We want to love on Jesus. Amen. We want to say, God, have your way in my life. Change me. I want to be challenged just like I was when I swore. I want to be challenged when I say something negative. I want that same Holy Ghost to challenge me about swearing, to challenge me about when I speak lies about myself. Amen. Church is drifting away from the presence of God. 2 Corinthians 10. Okay, do I have a Bible reading here? Two Corinthians. For though we walk, in verse 3, though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments, and every high thing that exalts itself above the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. It's amazing here when we read these things, it doesn't say, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down Satan and all the demon powers and all the princes. No, it's talking about things that are in your mind. Casting down imaginations. Friend, if you're imagining that nothing will change in your life, nothing will change. You've got to cast that down. You've got to start speaking life into that situation. You've got to start speaking truth into that situation. And I believe that God will deliver us. Amen. Have a quick look at 1 Corinthians chapter 10 as well. It says here in verse 1 Corinthians 10, verse 1, "Moreover, brethren, I do not want you to be unaware that all our fathers were under the cloud, all passed through the sea, and all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. All ate the same spiritual food, and all ate the same spiritual, drank the same spiritual drink. For they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them. That rock was Christ. But with most of them, God was not well pleased, for their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. Now these things became our example to the intent that we should not lust after evil things as they also lusted, and do not become idolaters as some of them. As was written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Let not sexual immorality, as some of them did, and in one day 23,000 fell. Let us not tempt Christ as some of them also tempted and were destroyed by serpents. Let's not complain," and all this that goes on. And this is children of God. Friend, these people were the children of God. Yes, they went into captivity for a period of time, 430 odd years. They went into captivity, but when they went, before they went in, they were God-fearing people. They were they were God's people. The blessing of God was on their lives. And circumstances and situations arose that they went into captivity as the Egyptians went lorded it over them. Friend, what happened to them in that period of time is that they started to do what they saw. They started to take on the ways of the Egyptians. This is the way the Egyptians lived. The Egyptians were people that were in idolatry. They were worshiping false gods. They were committing sexual immorality. They were doing all these things, and they started to see all this stuff. And here is God comes down, and he starts to move supernaturally and powerfully as the plagues come, and as they were delivered, as even as they came out with, they looted, they took the finances and that of Egypt, and out they came. But I want to tell you, their minds had been corrupted by the environment they lived in. Friend, we live in a world today, a world system that has been corrupted. It has been corrupted. Friend, I want to tell you, you can't live your spiritual life living one day a month or something, getting spiritually fed. Friend, I want to tell you, it's a day that we need daily to get hold of the Word of God, where we need to lift our hearts up to God, where we need to say, "God, will you deliver me from this body of death? Will you deliver me from this earth, this thing that the satanic force that's coming upon the world system that is infiltrating the church, is coming into the church. God, will you deliver that from us, that we might be a holy people, the Lord, that we might be a righteous people, that we might be a people living for you, my God, and not doing the things of the world?" Because you see, today, a lot of the things of the world that today are in the, that get into the church, somewhere or other, we accept. Friend, there's things there that we can't accept. Amen? You're very quiet out there. Is it okay? Are we doing all right? You want me to stop? Okay. Oh, dear Jesus, I don't know where I am because I just lost my notes. I believe that God's plan for man is a plan of deliverance, a plan to set us free, a plan to, you know, I believe that God's going to have a people called the church who will believe. I believe that God's word will not return to him void. I believe, and I said it last week, that this book is God-inspired, amen. I believe it holds the keys to meet every man's need. It's in the book, and it's not in philosophy. It's not in many Christians today, and even some of the pastors and that are going to psychiatrists and trying to somehow or other get their brains unscrambled. Friend, I want to tell you, we need a good dose of the Holy Ghost. We need a good outpouring of the Spirit of God that'll slay us all on the floor and get us crying out to God and drinking from that river and the wells of God, amen. The wells of our salvation, amen. I tell you what, I believe that God is moving by His Spirit. I believe that God wants to do some things. There's a man in the Bible, and he was a religious man, Zacharias. And here's this man as he's going through the procedures. He was loving God and he was a righteous man, the Bible says. He was a God-fearing man, he and his wife. And it was his time to go in and serve in the sanctuary. And he goes in there and does what he's supposed to be doing. And while he's doing all this stuff, an angel appeared to him. And the angel appeared to him and said, "Hey man, you're blessed. God has heard your prayers. And God is going to cause your wife Elizabeth to have a child. And he is going to be this and he's going to be that and he's going to be mighty and he's going to carry the anointing. He's going to be filled with the Holy Spirit from his mother's womb and he's going to go before Christ and he's going to, oh man." And you know what? Poor old Zacharias, he looked at this angel and he said, "How could anything like that ever happen?" What I'm trying to say is this. This man, because of years of perhaps wanting to have a child, years of prayer even, years of with his wife and going through the things, what happened to him? Discouragement got on the inside of him. Discouragement got inside of him to a point where he was most surely praying for something that he did not believe would happen. So when the angel comes and says, "Hey, this is what's going to happen. Your wife's going to bring forth and you're going to do this and you're going to, this is, and there's going to be joy and there's going to be all these things and it's going to be so exciting." All of a sudden, this man said, "This is impossible. This is impossible." And so what happened was the angel had to stop him from speaking, because otherwise he would have spoken negativity about something that God was going to do. We know that this man was mute for so long, but God, this angel said to him, he said, "You're going to call this son, this boy, John." After a period of time, you'll find this in the book of Luke, and after a period of time, Mary, I think Elizabeth was about 4 or 5 months pregnant. The angel came to a girl, a virgin girl, and said to this virgin girl, "The Holy Spirit is going to come. You're highly favored, and God is going to use your body. You're going to conceive, and you're going to bring forth the Messiah. You're going to bring forth the Son of God." And Mary, she said to Jesus, she said to this angel rather, she said, "How could this be?" There's nothing. See, what was happening here, she knew about the birds and the bees. She knew that to bring forth, there had to be a man. And she said, how can this be, seeing I know no man?" And I believe that the Spirit of God spoke to her in a way, because what she was talking about was something that had never been done before. Zechariah, he would have studied the Word of God. He would have studied Genesis. He would have studied the Word. He would have understood about a man that was old and the deadness of Sarah's womb. He would have understood that nothing is too hard for God. But because he had his mind was so scrambled and so messed up that he could not see, he could not hear what the Spirit was saying to him. Friend, what I'm saying today is we need to have our minds renewed because we've been so cluttered with stuff over the years, disappointment, sadness, sorrows, people that have died, people, things that have happened around our lives. We're so cluttered. But I'm saying what God is doing at this time is he's renewing our mind. He's starting to declutter all this stuff where we can say, Jesus, honestly, sincerely, I believe that there's nothing too hard for you. And I believe, my God, that you said in the last days you're going to pour out of your Spirit upon all flesh. You talk about a latter rain revival. I don't care if the church looks barren right now. I don't care if we haven't really seen a move of God's Spirit that we know is going to happen. It doesn't matter. But my God, according to your word, be it unto us, hallelujah. And God, we're going to believe you. We're going to put our trust in you, and we're going to put away wrong thinking. We're going to put away wrong stuff. See, you might think I'm crazy, but I honestly, sincerely believe that we are going to see a move of God's Spirit. I honestly believe that, not because of any preacher or anything like that. It's because God's word says it. And somewhere along the line, we have to separate ourselves from the world system, from what the world's trying to do, and grab hold of what God's doing in Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah. Hot in this place. Because our minds can be so cluttered. And I'm looking at here, here's an angel of God talking to this man and telling him, it's an amazing story. It really honestly is. I believe that God is going to build his church and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. See, we only hear what our level of faith will allow us to hear. And if our level of faith has been affected by negative thoughts and past failures and defeats and goodness knows what else, well, we'll have the same results as this man had. Unbelief removes what is important and we focus on negativity. Not the Bible, but I heard this many years ago. If God can get it to us, he will get it through us. If God can get the message to us, he will get it through us. I'm just going to read this verse in Luke chapter 1. Do not be afraid, Zacharias, for your prayer is heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son. You shall call his name John. You will have joy and gladness. He will be great in the sight of the Lord. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit from his mother's womb. He will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord. He will go before the Christ in the spirit and power of Elijah. Zacharias most probably never heard most of the conversation the angel had with him. He was still stumbling over his wife having a baby in her old age. And that's what came out of him. He said, how can this be? God stopped his mouth until the promise came to pass. I believe that he would have studied all that. I want to just read this story to you, and I pray that it helps us. It's in the book of Romans chapter 4. I'll close with this. Verse 17, it says, as it is written. Everybody say, as it is written. As it is written. Not because of some doctrine or some philosophy, but as it is written. I have made you a father of many nations in the presence of him whom he believed, God, who gives life to the dead and calls those things that do not exist as though they did. Friend, please, get this into your spirit. Get this. Let this do damage in our minds and in where the enemy has sown so much deception and so much lies and so much rubbish. Get it. Let this feel like it's getting hold of stuff and dragging it out. Amen. Anybody else need some of this? Amen. Because there's been a lot of stuff going on and a lot of rubbish. But I want to tell you, we've got the power of God to start to change some stuff. And I believe that God wants us to change some stuff. Let me just read this. God gives life to the dead and calls those things which do not exist as though they did. I believe the church is going to rise up out of the ashes. I believe the church of the living God is going to rise up and become a mighty army for God. Amen. I believe that backslidden Christians are going to come alive. I believe that ministries that have fallen over and broken down and smashed, God is going to raise them up in Jesus' name. Amen. I believe that there's going to come a mighty thing. Those things that are dead at the moment, God calls those things which do not exist as though they did, who contrary to hope in hope believed, so that he became the father of many nations according to what was spoken. Friend, God has spoken over us, the church, and he says he's going to do this and he's going to do that, and I believe he's going to do it in Jesus' name. Amen? Not what I see. So shall your descendants be. And not being weak in faith, he did not consider his own body already dead since he was about 100 years old and the deadness of Sarah's womb. He did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief. Hey, we're not going to waver, amen, at the promise of God through unbelief. There is going to come a revival. Our families will be saved. Our people, there will be a revival on the Sunshine Coast. There will be a move of God. The great Southland of the Holy Spirit will know a revival fire burning through it in Jesus' name. It's going to happen. It's going to rain. Did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God and being fully convinced that what he had promised, he was also able to perform. I believe what God has promised, he is able to perform. I believe in miracles. I believe in the Holy Spirit. I believe in the resurrection. I believe in the risen Christ. I believe in the power of God. Amen. I believe in the anointing. I believe as Jesus stood that day in Luke chapter 4 when he said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Because God has anointed me to preach the gospel." Church, it's time to rise up and start to cry out, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. God has anointed me." Get under the spout where the glory comes out. Position yourself so you can receive from God. We're not seeing, friends. We're not seeing it. What I'm talking about today might sound hocus pocus to a lot of people. What we're talking about today, we say, "Well, I've never seen that." The children of Israel, they'd been in bondage all those years, but they'd learned wrong things while they're in captivity. They learned wrong things while they're in that world system. Egypt is the world system. Lord, a lot of us have learned wrong things in that world system. We're in this world. We're in this system. We live in this. Though we live in this, we do not war according to the flesh. Because I believe that God wants us to take authority, amen, over the works of the enemy. We need our minds renewed. Anybody say amen? Amen. We need our minds renewed. Renew my mind, oh God. Renew my mind, O Lord. Let's stand to our feet today as the musicians come. I don't know about you this morning. There may be somebody here today and you do not know Jesus Christ as Lord of your life. You may be here today and long time ago Jesus was your Lord, but he's not anymore. You've sort of walked away. But I want to tell you, friends, God never walks away from you. He's here today and he might be tapping you on your shoulder. He might be just giving you a sense of his presence around your life. He might be just letting you know that he loves you with an everlasting love, that he cares for you. And if you're like that today and you want to acknowledge that you want to receive Jesus Christ as Lord of your life, you want to welcome him back into your life, you want to ask him back to come in and help you and lead you, guide you, protect you, reveal stuff, renew your mind. If you're like that today, you want to come back to Christ, you want Christ to come into your life, would you just quickly give me a wave? Say, that's me this morning. I want this Jesus to touch my life again. I want him to come into my life. I want him to forgive me. I want him now. If that's you, quickly, just slip up your hand. That's me today. That's me today.